Yes, welcome you back. And today we are going to look at the compounds of group four elements. And we are going to begin with the dioxides. So when you talk about the dioxides of group four elements, yeah, this is where we find, when we say dioxide, it means that we're having two oxygen atoms and then an element. So carbon forms carbon dioxide. So you need to know the formula of this oxide. Then silicon forms silicon dioxide. Then germanium forms germanium dioxide. Then tin forms tin dioxide. And lead forms lead dioxide, or lead for oxide. Apart from carbon dioxide, or others are solids. So all these ones are solids. So this is the formula of the oxide. The formula of the oxides, and carbon dioxide being a gas and these solids gives us the physical state. Then we want to know the type of bonding in each. In carbon dioxide, the type of bonding and structure, carbon dioxide has simple molecular, it's written simple molecular structure. Silicon has gotten giant covalent. And germanium has gotten steel giant covalent. And tin and lead have gotten giant ionic. So this one gives us the bonding and the structure. So the moment you know the bonding and the structure, which means that you are able to describe the trends in melting points of these. Okay, so now with bonding and the structure, you're going to realize that carbon dioxide has got simple molecular structure with the discrete molecules held by weak van der Waals forces of attraction. So this joint molecular structure has got weak molecules. Sorry, discrete. Discrete molecules, and these discrete molecules are held together by weak van der Waals forces of attraction. Whereas with others, like silicon and germanium, they have gotten giant covalent structure. And this giant covalent structure, okay, has got a they have got some tetrahedral structure, okay, where the molecules are continuously held by the strong covalent bonds, and therefore we have said that this one, which has got giant, they have got giant molecules, giant covalent structures with the three-dimension network, those have got a three-dimension network of strong covalent bonds, while tin four oxide and lead four oxide have got giant ionic structures held by strong ionic bonds. So this one, this information can let us explain why carbon dioxide is a gas, whereas silicon four oxide is a solid at a room temperature. Yeah, that is what can be that is what can be formed. Okay, in other words, we can explain the trend, and we are going to look at the melting points and maybe explain some of the few concepts. We're going to explain some of the few concepts. So let me get a question that can guide us through. Okay, let's begin with this question. Briefly explain why. Carbon dioxide, why carbon dioxide is a gas. Whereas silicon 4 oxide is a solid. At room temperature. Let's see the reason as to why. Explain why carbon dioxide is a gas. One, what we should need to know, if I'm showing you the structure of carbon dioxide, basically, which is this. Meaning, of course, the difference between the electronegativities of carbon and oxygen is negligible, making the compound or making carbon dioxide non-polar. Yes, and we have already said that it has discrete molecules with the simple molecular structure held by strong forces, held by weak van der Waals forces of attraction, okay? In your description, you have to tell us that carbon dioxide is non-polar. Polarity. You deduce polarity by looking at the electronegativities of these atoms making up this molecule. So carbon and oxygen have almost the same electronegativity. The difference is negligible, and therefore they are non-polar. Meaning carbon dioxide is non-polar. That is not enough. It has discrete molecules. It has got discrete molecules with a simple molecular structure. With a simple molecular structure, when we say discrete molecules, which means that molecules are separate and near each other, see? So it has discrete molecules with a simple molecular structure. And a simple molecular structure is held by the weak, or the molecules held by weak van der Waals forces of attraction. These forces of attraction can be easily overcome, which are easily overcome at room temperature. Keeping them far apart from each other. I'm going to explain this well. However, in silicon 4 oxide, each silicon atom is bonded to four is bonded to four oxygen atoms, is bonded to four oxygen atoms to form a tetrahedral structure form a tetrahedral structure, right? From a tetrahedral structure, which is continuous. Which is continuous from a giant molecular structure. From a giant molecular structure with very many strong covalent bonds. Very many strong covalent bonds that keep its molecules very close to each other. So that is why you have oxygen, silicon, oxygen. So like that. Now, the difference between these two molecules is, I've mentioned the word nonpolar and discrete molecules with simple molecular structure and the forces of attraction holding the molecules. And these are easily overcome, keeping molecules far apart from each other. You know, from kinetic theory of matter, solids or solid particles are very closely held together. While for gases, because you are looking at gas and solid, they are distant. Meaning that for these ones, for solids to be closely held together, they must be held by strong forces. And those strong forces are what we are calling the covalent bonds. But for these, for gases, this is solid, for gases to be separate, it means that the forces holding these particles must be very weak, so that these the forces holding these molecules must be very weak, so that these molecules keep separate from each other. Now, when you talk about carbon dioxide, it has got discrete molecules. The word discrete itself means separate. Separate molecules with the simple molecular structure. When the structure is, you have to tell me about the discreteness, you tell me about the structure, you tell me about the forces holding those molecules, okay? And you tell me that these are easily overcome, even at room temperature, to keep the molecules far apart from each other. All those are marking points. But for the case of silicon, we are saying that silicon is bonded to four oxygen atoms, is bonded to four oxygen atoms to form a tetrahedral structure. We form a tetrahedral structure. And this tetrahedral structure is continuous. Continuous is the opposite of discrete. Discrete, separate. But continuous, it means that the molecule, each silicon is held, is connected to four oxygen atoms, and that one keeps the structure of the silicon dioxide continuous to form a giant adjunct molecular structure, which is covalent. Okay, with the many strong covalent bonds, of course, adjunct molecular structure, it means that it continues. Even here, you can attach another silicon and four oxygen atoms. So the structure keeps continuing, and it will come up with a giant molecular structure with very many covalent bonds, and those covalent bonds keep its molecules very close to each other, taking the shape of the solid. So it's about the marking points. You have to show me bonding forces and the closeness, or how far apart the molecules are as a result of the forces holding those particles together. From here, we need to describe some other thing about the melting points. About the melting points. This one came in UNEB of 2018. It was question four. Let's answer that question. Since we are still on the forces of attraction, we can as well attempt the issue of melting point. The table below. Shows melting points of group four elements of group four dioxide, sorry. There wasn't something like protein, they were just like explain the trend in melting points. Of the oxides. So we have a compound here. Then we have melting point in degrees Celsius. The compounds, first compound is carbon dioxide. Melting point is negative, which is 6.5. Another one is silicon dioxide. Melting point is 1,700. Third one is germanium oxide. Melting point 1,116. Then we've got tin dioxide. Melting point is 1,827. Then we've got lead four oxide. And then the melting point is 752. So they want us to explain the trend in the melting points. Of course, when you explain the trend, the melting point, you have to show me how it increases. Actually, it is increasing from carbon dioxide to tin oxide and then decreases to lead, okay? But then we have to account for the melting point of each, right? So for example, with carbon dioxide. So you know carbon dioxide has a simple molecular, has a simple molecular structure with molecules. This molecular structure has got molecules held by weak van der Waals forces. Carbon dioxide has a simple molecular structure, okay, with molecules. We can say with discrete molecules held by weak van der Waals forces. of attraction, which are easily overcome, requiring a low amount of energy to break, which are easily overcome, thus having the lowest melting point. Two, now we go to silicon dioxide, germanium dioxide, and these ones have got giant covalent structures. So silicon dioxide and germanium dioxide have giant covalent structures with a three-dimensional network, which network is of strong covalent bonds, Yes, but then they have strong covalent bonds, giant covalent structures with the strong covalent bonds. But why is it that there is a difference? This one has 1,700 and this one has 1,116. We are going to find out that germanium, as you move down, of course, as you move down the group, germanium as an atom has a bigger atomic radius because the atomic radius increases down the group. So germanium has got a bigger atomic radius than silicon, making the covalent bond of germanium oxide longer and weaker. When the atomic radius is bigger, it means that the bond forms a bond which is bigger. And when the bond is long, this one simply means that when the bond is very long, it is very weak to be broken. That's why germanium has got little, requires little amount of energy to be broken. So can continue and say, however, germanium dioxide has a lower melting point, than silicon dioxide. Why? Because germanium as an atom has a bigger atomic radius, it makes the covalent bonds in germanium 4 oxide are longer and weaker than those of silicon 4 oxide. So much as they have the same structures, that is the covalent bonding, they have different melting points, and we associate that with the bond length and the strength of the bond. When you talk about germanium 4 oxide and silicon 4 oxide, just look at the atomic radii of these atoms. And look at the one with the higher atomic radius, or the big atomic radius, to mean that it has got its bond long. And when the bond is long, then it is weak. So the bond of the germanium oxygen bond in the dioxide of germanium is longer and weaker compared to the one in silicon. Right. Then also, tin foxide and lead foxide, of course, they have got giant ionic structures. Tin foxide and lead for oxide have giant ionic structures, and these structures are with strong ionic bonds. They both have, they have giant ionic structures with strong ionic bonds. But why is it that lead for oxide has a lower melting point than tin for oxide? We are going to use the same reasoning, okay? We are going to use the same reasoning because you have seen that. However, lead for oxide has a lower melting point than that of tin oxide. Okay, so what does it mean? It is simply because lead lead for iron, okay, has a bigger ionic radius, because now we are talking about ionic bonds, so you have to bring in the ions. Lead for iron has a bigger ionic radius. Okay, then tin for iron. Thus, lead for oxide has weak ionic bonds. Okay, it has weaker ionic bonds than tin oxide. So here you have to talk about one by one. Talk about why carbon dioxide is having the lowest. These ones have the same structures, but they have differences in the values of melting points. These ones have the same structures, but they have differences. So you have to associate it to types of bonding and then the atomic radii and the ionic radii of the molecules. So that is what we are having with the melting points. Okay, so now from here, we can tell now how these dioxides are formed. Okay, can bring it in as a question with equations. Describe how the dioxides of group 4 elements are formed. How are the dioxides of group 4 elements formed? Remember when we were looking at burning of these substances in air, we saw that when heated, we found that you can easily form the dioxides. Okay, you can easily form the dioxides. For example, with the carbon, silicon, germanium, and tin, okay? They give you the dioxides directly by burning them in oxygen. So allow me say that carbon 4 oxide, which is the carbon dioxide, carbon 4 oxide, silicon 4 oxide, right words, germanium 4 oxide, and tin for oxide are formed by heating elements in oxygen, by heating elements in oxygen. Okay. Then you can write the equation. Equations, we shall have carbon, solid plus oxygen, gas will form carbon dioxide gas. Then we shall have silicon, solid plus oxygen, gas, we shall form silicon dioxide. This is a solid, this is a solid. Then we have germanium, solid plus oxygen, gas, we form germanium for oxide, which is a solid. We have tin, solid plus oxygen, gas, we shall form tin for oxide solid. So this is how the oxides of these ones can be formed. But when it comes to lead, lead has gotten a different method of preparing its oxide or its dioxide. We can react trilead tetraoxide with the dilute nitric acid, okay? And say lead oxide is formed by reaction between dilead 2 dilead 2 nitrate no sorry dilead 2 then lead oxide. Or one can call it trilead tetraoxide. Trilead tetraoxide with the warm dilute nitric acid. So the equation would be trilead tetraoxide solid plus nitric acid shall form lead dioxide or lead oxide, and we shall also form lead nitrate. And water as what we form. So this reaction of trilead tetraoxide with nitric acid will get you form lead for oxide. Alternatively, still one can to get lead for oxide, one can heat. Okay. We can heat a mixture of lead oxide. No, we can heat a mixture of lead to nitrate. Sorry, lead to nitrate. And sodium chloride. And sodium chloride 1 at 300 degrees Celsius. So lead to nitrate was the solution. So we shall have lead 2 plus sodium chloride 1, right? ionic equation. Of course, so it takes place in presence of water. And you will form your lead two oxide solid. Your lead dioxide, sorry, lead for oxide, not lead dioxide. And shall form hydrogen ions. Two, then a chloride. So this equation can get you a lead for oxide. Also, you can as well heat, if you want lead for oxide, you can get it by heating a mixture of lead to nitrate. Of lead to nitrate. Calcium chloride one. And calcium hydroxide. So it means that you have lead two ions plus hydroxide ions from calcium, then plus a chloride, you form chloride ions, lead four oxide, water. That is it. So that is how we form the dioxides. Maybe now we rush and look at how these substances react. Now we need to look at the reactions because you've looked at how they are formed, physical properties of the melting points. Now let's look at how they react with compounds, especially alkalis and acids. Okay, so the reactivity of group 4 dioxides with the one dilute and concentrated acids. And two, with the dilute and concentrated alkalis. So how does this take place? We are going, let's begin with one. And let's begin with the dilute acids. Dilute acids. We need to first note that carbon dioxide, germanium 4 oxide, tin oxide, even lead oxide do not react with the dilute acids. They don't react with the dilute acids. But it is only silicon 4 oxide, you have to be using words, only silicon 4 oxide reacts with the dilute hydrofluoric acid. hexafluoric acid to form hexafluorosilicic acid. Hexafluorosilicic acid. Spelling hexafluorosilicic acid and water. Or you can form silicon tetrafluoride and water. Or one can form silicon tetrafluoride and water. This is the case when it is a dioxide, but when it is an element, you must form strictly hexafluorosilicic acid. But when it is a dioxide, you can form hexafluorosilicic acid and water, or silicon tetrafluoride and water. How do you write the equation? Silicon dioxide plus hydrofluoric acid, you form hexafluorosilicic acid and water. Or you can have silicon dioxide plus hydrofluoric acid to form silicon tetrafluoride is a gas, and then water. You need to know that silicon dioxide is an acidic oxide and therefore cannot react with other dilute strong acids, but it reacts with hydrofluoric acid simply because hydrofluoric acid is a weak acid, okay? And the fluorine atom has got very small atomic radius and is highly electronegative. So it reacts with the only hydrofluoric acid. But with the concentrated acids, that was the case of dilute acids, don't leave out this point that the others do not. You have to write it. And then you put an exception, an exception where they react. Now, to talk about concentrated acids, reaction with the conc acids. With the conc acids, still silicon oxide will react. But what I want you to know, I want you to know about others, carbon dioxide, germanium 4 oxide, tin 4 oxide, do not react with concentrated acids at all. You don't react with concentrated acids. But silicon 4 oxide, I've excluded lead because lead 4 oxide reacts with the dilute acid. So silicon 4 oxide reacts with the concentrated hydrofluoric acid. You have to write the word concentrated hydrofluoric acid only to form hexafluorosilicic and water, or you can as well form silicon tetrafluoride. And water. So we had written this equation, but because we are talking on a different case, you have to rewrite it. Being concentrated hydrofluoric acid, you can use liquid or aqueous steel. You form and of course water, or you form and water. Then with lead, this lead for oxide reacts with the concentrated hydrochloric acid. Form lead for chloride. Lead for chloride is a yellow liquid. And the water. So the equation would be lead for oxide PbO2 plus hydrochloric acid from lead for chloride. You know, liquid, it's a liquid, and water. Right, then that is actually, it is lead for oxide reacts with the chloride concentrated. It is called, this is chloride concentrated. Chloride concentrated. But if it is excess chloride concentrated acid, you form different products. So let's see that. Lead for oxide, all this content is needed, reacts with excess called concentrated hydrochloric acid to form complex hexachloroplambate, one word, hexachloroplambate for ions and water. So we shall have lead for oxide equation, lead for oxide, solid plus hydrogen ions plus 6 chloride ions. We shall form hexachloroplambate 4 ions and water. I told you the logics of performing the numbers of inorganic chemistry very well is to master the balancing. These balancing points, the more you practice, the more they enter your head. Seriously. So with excess chloride concentrated acid, we form the hexachloroplambate for iron and the water. But if the acid is hot and concentrated, lead for oxide reacts with the hot concentrated hydrochloric acid to form, when it is hot concentrated, we form chlorine lead to chloride. Chlorine lead to chloride and water. Chlorine lead to chloride and water. Molecular equation, lead for oxide, solid, reacting with hydrochloric acid to form lead took right chlorine gas and water. You can write an ionic equation. You can write lead to oxide plus four hydrogen ions plus two chloride ions. Why not four? Because this side would be two. When you bring them this side, it will be two chloride ions, forming lead two ions plus chlorine gas, and then two molecules of water. It goes further to react with hot concentrated sulfuric acid. Still, lead reacts with the hot concentrated sulfuric acid to form, we form oxygen, lead to sulfate, oxygen lead to sulfate, and water. So how we shall have lead to oxide, two molecules plus two molecules of sulfuric acid, form two molecules of lead to sulfate, oxygen gas, and two molecules of water. So this is how these compounds react. But basically, in particular, we've seen that lead four oxide is the one which reacts much. So that is what we are having. Then let's end with the reactions with alkalis. That was two. With the dilute alkalis. Surprisingly, it is only carbon dioxide that reacts with the dilute alkalis to form a carbonate and water, or a hydrogen carbonate and the water. With the dilute alkalis, it is the carbon dioxide, not one word, it is carbon dioxide reacts with the cold dilute alkalis from a carbonate and water. We can form a hydrogen carbonate. So if they had specified like sodium hydroxide, it would be better. But since they have said dilute alkalis, you're going to can write to OH. Well, OH is from a soluble base, which is an alkali, to form a carbonate. And water, form a carbonate and form a carbonate and water. Or carbon dioxide gas plus hydroxide can form a hydrogen carbonate. Others do not react with dilute alkalis. So silicon dioxide, germanium dioxide, tin foxide, lead foxide, all these do not react with dilute alkalis. they do not react with dilute alkalis. So that is what we are having. With dilute alkalis, this is the information that we are having. So from here, can look at reactions with the concentrated alkalis. With the concentrated alkalis, carbon dioxide, beginning with carbon dioxide, reacts with the hot conch alkyls to form a carbonate and water. And you write the equation carbon dioxide gas plus an alkyl to form a carbonate and water. You form a carbonate and water. You form a carbonate and water. Then silicon dioxide reacts with hot conch alkyls to form a silicate. From a silicate and water. So we shall have silicon dioxide is a solid, so plus a hydroxide, we form a silicate and water. Then with germanium for oxide, it reacts with the hot conch alkyls to form a germanate four. Germanium forms a germanate four. How do you form a germanate four? How do you form a germanate four? Here we shall have germanium. Shall have germanium four oxide, which is a solid. It reacts with hydroxide ions from the alkali and we say that we form a germanate four. Or plus hydroxide in presence of water, you form a germanate four plus, yeah, here you just form a germanate four because you have water, you have added water. Then 14, oxide reacts with
hot-conc alkyls to form austenite 4. Yeah, we form austenite 4. How do you write the equation? We shall have tin oxide plus fluoride oxide ions, which have formed austenite 4, SnO3, plus water. Alternatively, can have SnO3, O2, sorry, plus 2H plus two molecules of water, we form austenite 4, SnOH, 6, 2 minus. The same applies to lead. Lead 4 oxide reacts with hot concentrated alkalis to form a plumbate 4, PbO3, 2 minus, aqueous, and water liquid. This is what we call a plumbate, Or, alternatively, lead 4 oxide reacts with hydroxide and water to form a plumbate 4. As simple as that. So, now a student who really looks at the question involving dioxides can be able to get all the marks. The part left at dioxides is the redox properties of dioxides. After that, after looking at the redox properties of dioxides, one should be able to do the question of 2018, all of it, because we did the part of melting points. There is a part that requires they wanted the students to compare the reactivity of oxides with dilute acids and with dilute alkyls using equations. Then observation that would take place when lead 4 oxide was warmed with concentrated hydrochloric acid. Then another one was the redox property. So our next move is the redox properties of group 4 dioxides. See you there. Thank you for listening.